Hi, and welcome to How to Get the Most Out of Your Next 24 Hours by Playing the Long Game. Today, we're joined by Dori Clark. She's an author, she's a consultant, she's an educator, and I just found out she's also a stand-up comedian. Now, Dori, I always thought you were funny, but I didn't know you were like professionally funny. So that was a great revelation for me.
I'm not sure there's a large percentage of people that would pay me a lot of money to do stand-up, but I have, in fact, performed on stages in New York, so...
Awesome. Awesome. So listen, last time we talked, I messed up and I'm here for some redemption. I made a big point about how one of my favorite authors, which is very true. And I tried to name all your books and I messed up. I'm not sure if you remember that or not, but it was very embarrassing. So right now, what I want you to do is quiz me. Quiz me on the names of your books and I'm going to try to respond accordingly.
Ooh, okay. Fantastic. Let's see. Gee, Terry, I wrote a book about professional reinvention. What was that called?
It was called Reinventing You. Great book.
Amazing. Okay. I wrote a book, appropriately enough, I think it ties in with part of the institution that is sponsoring this webinar. It's about how to become an entrepreneur and create multiple streams of revenue in your business. What's that called?
That one's called Entrepreneurial You. Give me another one.
Oh my God. Okay. Fantastic. You're doing great here. This is amazing. Okay. I wrote a book about an elderly sea captain and his philosophical voyages. What was that called?
Catcher in the Rye.
Amazing. It was a trick question and you nailed the trick. All right. Well, I think you're doing great. This is fantastic and I'm honored to be here.
I am too, but by the way, I was cheating because I have all your books right here. And I'm also holding another book here called The Long Game, How to Get the Most Out of Your Next 24 Hours. So do you mind just unpacking just the general theme of what The Long Game is?
I certainly can, my man. I see you and I raise you. And The Long Game is basically a book about how the subtitle is how to be a long-term thinker in a short-term world. And ultimately, it is about how to apply the lens of strategic thinking on your life and your business and your career.
Awesome. So listen, I have a lot of questions. We have a lot of people attending as well that have questions. Please don't hold back. Pop those in there. I'll make sure we get to them throughout the conversation. But I want to start with the one that's top of mind for me. All right. So pretend I'm an emerging entrepreneur. I just started running my business. And you're saying, Terry, you got to play the long game, but I need now money. How do I balance my time between playing the long game strategically, but then supporting myself in the short term?
This is such an important question, obviously. And, you know, all of us have been here, right? When it comes to playing the long game, one of the concepts that I actually talk about in the book is what I call thinking in waves. And what I mean by this is that we have to recognize that there are seasons that all of us need to follow. You can't keep doing the same thing all the time and assuming that that's going to work. I mean, any of us who've tried marketing, for instance, right? You know, people are like, oh yeah, well, Facebook ads are it. Do Facebook ads. And then, you know, everybody's doing Facebook ads and all of a sudden, wait, it's not working anymore. You can't keep doing the same thing and just assuming, oh yeah, magic will happen. You need to learn when and how to shift strategy. And so if you are early in your entrepreneurial journey, you're exactly right, Terry. The thing you need to do is get clients now. And that is, you know, knocking on doors, literally or metaphorically, talking with prospects and getting business in the door. It's all about sales. But ultimately, a major mistake that I see a lot of entrepreneurs make is that they keep up with that. That's great. You know, if you're going to have a successful business, doing sales all the time is amazing. But it becomes a problem if you keep doing it for a really long time and you neglect marketing. And the reason for that is that sales often is not incredibly scalable because the people you know, they might refer you, but they know people like themselves. And if you want to grow exponentially rather than just incrementally, you need marketing in order to expose yourself and your business to a new audience. So over time, as we're thinking in waves, early on, you over-index on sales, but eventually you need to level up your marketing as well so that you can grow your business for the long term.
That's a really good point because what I found is often when you first start a business, you get a lot of clients through referrals. You tell your network, hey, I have this new thing. They come flooding in and you're so busy working in your business, you don't work on your business. And then 6 to 9 months later, you're like, wait, I don't know how to do sales or marketing because everyone knows my cousin, right? So I think I'm glad you brought that up. And you also need just time to think. because if you're so busy doing, you don't have time to be present and just to think strategically. And you mentioned in your book, I don't want to butcher the stats, but these executives in this study said, like, you know, strategic thinking is responsible for like 97% of my success, but like 96% said they never do it or they don't do it often enough. Can you correct those stats on me and just unpack like the need for just making white space for strategic thinking?
Yeah, you had the basic idea right. Yes, 97% of senior leaders said strategic thinking is key to their success. And you're exactly right, 96% said they just don't have time to do it, which obviously, you know, strikes almost all of us on the surface as being pretty problematic. So if almost everyone thinks something's important, if almost no one is doing it, first of all, congratulations, because if you do, it means you have a massive competitive advantage over other people. So this is really, if we're talking about a growth edge for you in your business, actually carving out time and getting good at strategic thinking and long-term thinking is one of the very best investments you can make in your business. So a point that I like to make in the long game, it's not that it takes huge amounts of time. Like, let's be clear, I don't have time for strategic thinking does not mean, oh, wow, I wish I could take a year off and go meditate, because then after the ashram, I would, you know, be enlightened. No one has time for that. That is not what we mean. It's just a little time, right? We need just enough distance and breathing room so that we actually can ask ourselves the right questions, including, should I actually be doing this task? Am I doing the right things to get me to the goals that I want to reach? Is there perhaps a more efficient way to try this? Could I try something else? Could I outsource this? Could I delegate it? Does it need to be done? If we ask ourselves those questions periodically, we can actually get where we want to go a heck of a lot faster. But most of us are so overbooked and overscheduled, we never even have a breath to do that.
I know a couple of years ago you did a time tracking study, and I have two questions. Was that scary? Because I'm afraid to do so. And what revelations came from that? So again, you're sitting down, you're tracking your time, how you're spending it, I think for a month or so. What light bulb moments came from that?
Yeah. So this, I'm proud of having done it, Terry. Not so much because it was scary. It wasn't exactly scary, but it was boring. I'm not going to lie. I think this is the reason that a lot of people don't do it. It is so boring to just like actually write down like I did it in 15 minute increments for a month. Like, I would leave an Excel spreadsheet open on my computer. And so every time I would come back after a break or whatever, it's all right, I just spent a half an hour having lunch and, you know, like all these things. But I did it twice. I did it in February of 2018. And then I did it again in December of 2020 because I wanted to actually see during the pandemic to track it how my time usage was different. But I did learn a couple of things that I think have been quite useful. And I break this down in the long game as well. One, which I think was especially helpful for anyone that struggles sometimes with social media and how we use social media, which, you know, maybe is a lot of us. I noticed, and again, you can see this when you're tracking your time. Almost always when I was using social media for what I will call non-business purposes, and what, you know, what I mean, if it's a business purpose, it's like, oh, okay, Terry just did a great webinar with me. I need to post a link to that on the internet or something like that. That's okay. That takes 2 minutes. It's a business use. It's very clear. But if I'm just scrolling, right, if we're kind of wasting time on the internet, almost always I was doing that between 10 and 11 o'clock at night. And it made me realize, oh, wait a minute. Why am I doing this? It was always because it was a period of time when I was too tired to actually work, but I was not tired enough to go to sleep. And so it was just kind of this like stupid amusement. And I realized, wow, if I'm just a little bit more deliberate, if I just say to myself, oh, wait, Dory, there's something better you could do. You could read a book or you could watch a documentary you've been wanting to do. Just that little redirect has been very powerful. And so actually from 2018, when I first did the time tracking, to 2020, when I repeated it, my time usage on social media, actually, it was pretty low to begin with. It plummeted even further. So I've gotten that much tighter about the usage of my time. The second thing that I'll just mention, Terry, because it might be useful to some of your viewers, is what I call good multitasking. And what I mean by this, we've all heard about the perils and the pitfalls of multitasking. So we know that, you know, it would be bad, for instance, if I was trying to do this interview with you and simultaneously write an email, you know, we're using the same cognitive capacity. But if you are doing what I will dare to call good multitasking, which is where essentially, you know, largely you're combining a physical task and a cognitive task. So, and you can do each of them equally well. So like I'm taking a walk and I'm calling my mom. I am exercising and I'm listening to an audiobook or whatever. I'm commuting and I'm listening to a podcast, whatever it is. You are actually able, I counted the time twice because you're able to do both equally well. And so through strategic multitasking, I was actually able to increase my total number of hours that I had available at my disposal by nearly 30%. So it was a huge gain in terms of my time efficiency. So that's one tip that I'll pass along.
I counted two tips. And by the way, I do appreciate the time you spend on social media because everyone wants to see your cats on Instagram. So don't stop doing that. We need those updates. But one thing that comes to mind as we're chatting is you have a section in your book just called white space, giving yourself the time just to again, be present, to think strategically. And I think there's a few tools we can use to get more white space. One is just saying no. I mean, someone reached out to me the other day on LinkedIn asking for something that I don't even do. And she's like, hey, well, can we connect? I'm like, I don't even do that. So no. Another's asking why, you know, why do I have to be at this meeting? Why do we have to connect? And a few weeks ago, this other guy on LinkedIn, his name's Ty Lambert. He reached out to me and said, hey, Terry, can we chat about this new thing I'm doing? And I said, why? He sent me a video in a Google Doc explaining why. And I was like, this is amazing. Yes, we can talk. So I think those tools we have, know and why, are very powerful. But I know you have a whole section of the book on that. Can you unpack how we get this white space more often?
Yeah, absolutely. And you're right to home in on asking more strategic questions, right? Early on, when I, you know, when I was like young and early in my career, I didn't have a lot going on. And so literally, if anyone was like, hey, let's have a networking meeting, I'm like, and that's so exciting. Yeah. You know, and I was just say yes to everything. But I think it's really important to be explicit. If we are still following that strategy of like, hey, anytime anyone says, let's do something, if we're still following that when we're 5 years, when we're 10 years into our career, when we're, God forbid, when we're 20 years into our career, that is a recipe for disaster. Because what we need to do, you know, much like as we think about thinking in waves, much like as early entrepreneurs, we need to do a lot of sales, but over time ratchet up our marketing so that we're speaking to new audiences. What we need to do in terms of our own time management is early on, we need to, you know, say yes to everything. Hey, why not? We can meet some people, we can learn some things. But over time, we need to decrease the yeses and increase the noes, because ultimately what we are judged on, what our success is judged on, I can tell you, it's not the number of coffees, it's not the number of emails, it's not the number of, you know, brain picking Zoom calls. It is the projects that we independently create and execute on. And so we need to be protecting that time and guarding it. So our criteria need to tighten. So a big one, as you say, is just, you know, sort of asking for more information. You can actually weed out probably 50 to 75% of the people looking to do something because they haven't actually put a lot of thought into it. They might misconstrue what it is you do. They might actually have, I will call it, a nefarious agenda that they don't want to tell you, you know. So like, gosh, you know, why do you want to meet? Well, if the answer is, well, I want you to give me money, they're probably not going to say it. So what are they going to do? They're going to go away. So that's actually what we want. We want to scare away the people with bad intentions or not useful intentions, because we want the good people, the people that are willing to make the effort, the people that truly want to connect with us, we want to make it easier for them to get in and harder for everybody else to get in.
Yeah, I find it useful to give people homework sometimes. Like they'll ask me a question, I'll say, can you go look at this first, then get back to me, and then they're gone, right? They never come back. So I like the fact that you're putting up these borders with your time. And in the book, you mentioned how early in your career, someone would say, hey, let's go meet for coffee. And you'd like go far away from your apartment, waste all that time in the train and, you know, just have some coffee or whatever. But as you matured, you're like, look, no, come here. And that's what I do now too. I'm like, no, come to Crown Heights, Brooklyn, we can talk. But I'm not going to Midtown Manhattan with four kids at home. So I appreciate those tips you're passing on. And I think really the goal here is, or one of the goals here is to be able to focus more. And focusing, I think, is harder than filtering. Because filtering, you can easily filter out a horrible idea. But focus is saying like, no, this is what's really important to me. And I have to say no to even some really good ideas, some really good opportunities, even if they are revenue generating, because I care more about the long term, not the short term. So on your end, you know, how do we find this initial guidance? How do we understand what's important to us and what we want to focus on?
Yeah. So when it comes to figuring out where we want to focus and how all this works, there's a few principles that we can keep in mind. I mean, one that I think is really useful is something that I talk about in the long game, which I call optimize for interesting, and kind of, you know, a little rule of thumb that we can use. Years ago, I made a documentary film, and it was an environmental documentary, and the heroine was this 80-something woman who years before had helped successfully lead the cleanup of one of America's most polluted rivers. And she was, you know, we were doing these early interviews with her about her life and what shaped her life. And she was telling the story about when she was heading off to college and her mother's advice to her. And her mother said, whenever you have a choice of what to do, pick the more interesting option. And I thought, oh, well, that's helpful. Yes. Like, you know, let's try that. Because sometimes, you know, you really are in a situation where it's like, well, where should I vacation? Should I vacation in the place that like my family has gone every year for the past 5 years? Or should I try something new and see what happens and see what we learn and see what we discover? Or, you know, oh, I have a chance to see, you know, to go to the movies, or I have a chance to see a Broadway show. What should I do? And that can be a helpful lens. But one thing that I actually really appreciated, Terry, and I was so honored that you let me interview you for the long game, is that oftentimes it really comes down to, just in an overarching sense, you know, business and life obviously are not separate. This is a holistic package. And so you told the story about how early on in your consulting career, you got a very lucrative offer from a company that wanted to bring you in as a consultant. They were going to pay you a ton of money. A lot of people would have just jumped at it. And if money were the only criterion, probably you would have said yes. But what you realized, maybe you can tell us a little bit more about this, is that the cost was more than you wanted to pay for this seemingly lucrative offer. So what was going on there, my man?
Yeah, thanks for giving me a chance to share that. So this is like a month into starting my consulting business. I had just left Facebook, and this company in Long Island wanted me to help them develop this lifestyle website, kind of like BuzzFeed, getting organic Facebook traffic to the website. And they're like, you know, we'll give you this huge retainer. I think it was like around $20,000 a month to do so, which was a lot, roughly, especially based on how I was doing. But I drove out to their office and I'm like, well, I'm still driving. And I was like,
and then you were in the ocean and you're like, what?
Yeah. And I was like, this will be my life every day. And at the time I had a newborn daughter. I'm like, I would never see her at this rate, you know? So it's like, you think about the trade-off that's involved. Like, sure, you're making all this money, but you know, at that point it would have been my only client. I wasn't jazzed about it whatsoever. And so I said no, but I'm so glad I did, because shortly after, that's when organic reach on Facebook tanked. So imagine if I had to shut down my operations and said, sure, yeah, I'm going to drive to Long Island, or even move there, God forbid, as some people suggested. And all of a sudden, oh, by the way, there's no more free traffic on Facebook. I'd have been in trouble. But it also encouraged me, because I said, look, you turned down $20,000 to make this business work. You got to go at it today, all right? Because otherwise, you did make a mistake. So it actually encouraged me to just keep on finding those opportunities I was excited about and push forward from there.
Yeah, I love that. It's so powerful. You know, we have to really know what is guiding us so that we can make choices that are consistent with those values.
So let's go into the boring stuff. And I want to share another story from your book. Not boring. That was a bad lead-in. But I know you have this online course, Recognized Expert, right?
And a totally non-boring online course. That is correct.
I agree. Yeah. And you mentioned in 2020, you were able to kind of turn it on and start ramping up sales for the Recognized Expert because you weren't touring as much. So people might think, I'll attest to this, making an online course can be boring. You get sick of hearing yourself talk, right? And it's challenging. It takes time. But the benefit is, like, once 2020 hit, you already had this revenue stream you could turn on. And my personal philosophy is to be purpose-driven, prepared, and patient. And I think you embodied all of that by having this course, like, you know, obviously generating revenue in the short term, but just ready in the long term if you need it as well. Can you just, again, go deeper into this strategic patience, as you refer to it? How do you push through the boring stuff when you're seeing everyone else just winning on social media and you're still like sitting there working on like your outline for one thing or another? How do you push through those challenges?
Yeah, it's a great question. So basically what you're referring to is I actually started experimenting with online courses in 2014. And I did my first course then with a different partner, sort of educational partner. And, you know, early on, there was so much I didn't know. I'm like, how do I put this together? Like, how does this work? I don't know about the marketing. There were a million things. But my attitude early on was, okay, I'm just going to experiment and I'm going to learn. I'm going to do it with an entity because I want to understand and kind of, you know, like almost apprentice, like I want to learn under their tutelage how to structure something like this. And so in 2014, I made one online course. In 2015, I made another online course with a different partner. And, you know, I have to say for each of these courses, like, I mean, they took hours. Like the one that I made in 2014, I had to like fly across the country to do it. It was, I think, 12 hours of live in front of a camera instruction. I mean, it was enormous. And of course, you have to prepare for all of that. And within a few years afterwards, I had, you know, for each of these courses made, you know, a couple thousand bucks. I mean, it was just like completely a bust, you could say. I mean, it's like, okay, it's not nothing, but for the amount of effort that it was, it just was like preposterous. But one of the themes that I really sound a lot in The Long Game is that it's about times at bat. You need to be trying lots of different things. And so the crucial thing was that for 7 years now, I have been learning about online courses and all the different, you know, ups and downs and variables and, you know, what I liked and what I didn't like. And so those particular things, they've never been especially lucrative. I mean, one of them now has probably brought in about 10 grand over a 7-year period. I mean, you know, I'm grateful for it. But again, it was a lot of effort and a lot of time to do that. But what it did was that learning enabled me to try other things. And so in 2016, I started launching my own online course. And I now had, you know, on the sort of the backs of other people and working with them, I had learned enough that I'm like, oh yeah, I'll try it for myself. And I ended up launching my flagship course, which is called Recognized Expert. And over the past 5 years, that's brought in, you know, well over $1 million. And that, you know, this is money that, you know, it's not with a partner. I'm able to access it, which is fantastic. I would never have been able to do it if I hadn't done the kind of unsuccessful ones before. And as you're alluding to, Terry, I am a big fan. This was actually the topic of my previous book, Entrepreneurial You, about creating multiple revenue streams in your business. I'm a big fan of diversification because we just do not know what's coming down the pike. I used to make a ton of money from keynote speaking. I was traveling every week, every other week, probably 30 to 50 keynote talks per year. That, as you might imagine, completely evaporated during COVID, but also interest in online courses shot through the roof. And so I had the most successful launch ever for the Recognized Expert program because of that groundwork having been laid.
Yeah, you make a really good point in regards to having multiple revenue streams. And when I'm talking to people who are like early stage entrepreneurs, or maybe they're doing even better, I'm like, you should have a maximum amount that you want to make every month, which sounds counterintuitive, but maybe it's $5,000, right? After you hit that $5,000 from transactional revenue, start building out other revenue streams, right? Maybe you'll never, you won't get the money for it, you know, month one, month two, month four, but like if something happens, you can turn that revenue stream up or you can build it up over time. But if you spend so much time on your core business, you don't have time to explore these things to fail while still being able to pay your mortgage. So I think we get so short-sighted sometimes. We're like, oh, things are going great now, but like your knowledge is a hub. And you can monetize it in several different ways, but if you're just stuck in that one zone, you don't get a chance to do so. And, you know, you mentioned creating online courses and how that's challenging. I was recording once for about 4 hours before I realized my microphone wasn't plugged in.
Oh, that's so sad.
It's actually happened twice. So I should probably learn from my mistakes.
I'm sorry, my man.
But my mindset was like, you know what? It's going to be even better now because I've rehearsed. Right. So I know in your book, there's another section just on keeping the faith. How do we do this? How do we keep the faith when or if we're getting a plug in our microphone, when we're getting turned down for opportunity after opportunity, how do you keep going forward with a positive mindset in the face of this adversity?
Yeah, that is the question, right? We all, you know, on the entrepreneurial journey have tons of setbacks, right? I mean, I wish we didn't. That's the thing. You know, you asked earlier about strategic patience, which is a concept that I talk about in The Long Game. I wish we didn't have to be patient. That would be so nice if we could just like get all the things. It is not that I am valorizing things taking a long time. I am not. I would much rather they happen quickly, but just the reality is that they often take a long time. And so if we want to deal with that rather than, you know, just being like, you know, negative jerks that no one wants to be around, we have to find a way to reconcile ourselves to the fact that things take a while. And that is where strategic patience comes in. For me, you know, when you hear the advice, you know, the kind of like mom advice about like, just be patient. So often to me what that connoted was just like, you know, pat you on the head, like just sit back. It'll be okay. Just work hard. It'll take care of itself. And I'm like, no, it won't. Like, that's not, you know, like, how do you know that? I don't know that, you know, like I want to do something. And so strategic patience is about placing little bets and watching them and monitoring them. It's not like you just sit back on your Barca lounger and let life come to you. That's not how life works. You place a bet, you put your money down, you see what happens, and then you adjust and you pivot as necessary. I think that's really what we need is patience with an understanding. Okay, this might take a while, but I'm going to watch this thing and I'm going to make sure that it's heading in the direction that I want. So how do we stay resilient? How do we come back if we're having setbacks? And, you know, I'll say, as you saw, Terry, I have an entire chapter in the book where I talk about specifically for me, because I wanted to put this out there, no matter where you are in your career. I mean, this is now like my fourth book. I've done plenty of stuff, but I continue to get rejected all the time. It's just, you know, you kind of get rejected by, you know, better and better things. But I mean, that's like cold comfort, like, oh, good, I got rejected by a real class A operation. And so I write about, you know, that like in 2019, so pre-COVID, all these rejections. There was this major media outlet I was going to write for. They put me through a million hoops. Finally, they're just like, no. I was going to co-write a book with a famous author. And then the end, like, no, that didn't work. I was hoping to speak at a big conference and they like totally blew me off and never got back to me. You know, all these things. So how do we do it? I think probably the most, there's a lot of ways, but the most important thing, the most important message is that I think too many of us give away our power by assuming that the gatekeepers actually know what they're doing. I think too many of us, if one person says no, we never try again, or we back off, or we say, oh God, I guess I'm not good enough. I guess that's not gonna work. One person telling you no is never enough to back off. There's a million reasons, including just their inbox is too busy or whatever, they had a bad day, that they're saying no to something. It does not mean you're not good enough. Fine if 100 people tell you no, but if you're giving up after one or two or half a dozen, you have not even started. And it is wrong. It is absolutely wrong to listen to those people and derive some kind of a judgment about yourself.
You bring up a great point. The founders of Fatherly, it's like a dad blog, they pitched the idea to all these VCs and they're like, it's a good idea, but we don't really get why this is useful. So they kept on getting rejected over and over again, but they realized we're talking to the wrong people. Like, these are guys who have kids, but they have like nannies and all pairs and this, they don't really do much. So they're like, why would you want to read a book about parenting? You know, what's the use of this blog? So sometimes you're hearing no from the wrong audience. And to your point, it's like, you got to keep on pushing through. And you mentioned how you got rejected, you know, for these larger opportunities. I think it's great to share that, because sometimes when you hit a certain level, people think you're just winning all the time. And Jason Pfeiffer, who's the editor-in-chief of Entrepreneur Magazine, he mentioned how he got rejected from writing an article for the New York Times. Now, what's funny is about a month before that, his wife had a great article in the New York Times. So I'm like, that's got to sting even more when you're at the dinner table and you get that email and it's like, all right, well, at least one of us made it. But I think
that's right. Perfect example.
Yeah. And I think just being able to push through that adversity, that's part of it, because then you have a story to tell that people can associate themselves with. It's like, you weren't winning all the time. You know, you had these frustrations too, but you managed to push through it successfully.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's right on. And there's also a really important point, which is that we often get so hung up about accomplishing a certain thing in a certain way that our vision almost narrows, and we don't realize if a door is shut, there's usually windows to come in, right? So there's a lot of different ways to do this. So, I mean, just to be specific, so with the long game, right, the publisher sends out all kinds of different things for like excerpts and whatever. I mean, you know, I obviously, if you're, you know, trying to be responsible as an author, you're doing marketing yourself, but the publisher and their publicity team is sending out all kinds of things. So we're going through the list. So Jason Pfeiffer from Entrepreneur apparently turned down the long game for doing an excerpt. No, not interested. Well, okay, Jason Pfeiffer, fair enough, man. I'm coming in the window, buddy. And I get to talk with you, Terry. So I think for everything, there's other options and there's other opportunities.
Yeah, I'll have to share that with them. Let me ask you a question, because I think it's very relevant to what you said in the book, where the outcomes you get from your work aren't linear. You might spend like 5 years grinding, and there's that one moment where you find success, and the next 5 years are just exponentially better than you know you could have imagined. But one game I like to play, and I'm wondering if you do the same thing, is when I'm in a big opportunity, I'll reverse engineer what got me there. Like, why am I here right now? So, for example, I spoke at South by Southwest before, and I'm like, why am I on this stage? Let me reverse engineer it. And it goes back to me going on the WeWork messaging board saying, hey, can someone help me get a job at this company called General Assembly? I want to start teaching there. One random person said yes. I started working at General Assembly, taught hundreds of classes there. And eventually they're like, hey, do you want to go speak at South by Southwest? But it all started with this woman who responded to my random message at WeWork. And 3 years later, I'm on this stage. So have you ever done the same thing where you're like, wait, why am I, how this even happen? And realize the value literally of the long game.
I love that you did that, Terry. I think that's so smart. And I really would encourage everybody to do it, because it helps you understand, you know, this is very much like, you know, the butterfly, you know, flapping the wings, right? And, you know, creates the monsoon. But it's true. And we often just don't recognize it. But it helps us to understand, okay, what are the things we can control? You know, we can't control the outcome, but we can control the process. And so what are the things that we are doing that's putting us in the right zone to receive good opportunities? So actually, in the long game, I break down, you know, kind of a cool thing. This might even be one of the coolest things that I've had the opportunity to experience. I was a producer on a jazz album that ended up winning 2 Grammys. And as a result, you know, we're nominated for these Grammys. I got to go to the Grammys. I got to be on stage at the Grammys helping to accept this award, which is so wild. It's not anything that I had ever anticipated. But so in the book, I actually break down the process of how did I get there? You know, I mean, it's not like I'm even a jazz musician or anything like that. But it all came from actually a series of 6 or 7 people through which I had connected to a guy that was the lead producer on the album, and then brought me in. So tracing all of it back and where it started, again, this is the part you can control, is a number of years ago, when I first started writing for a particular publication, I decided, oh, you know, I want to get to know all the other people who write for this publication. Like, these seem like cool people. This seems like a good, you know, kind of tribe for me to be part of. So I was just reaching out to folks, and I had just moved to New York. And so there was a guy that I knew lived in New York. And so I sent him a message. I'm like, hey, we both write for this place. Do you want to get coffee? And he was like, okay. And so we got coffee. And he literally said, oh, hey, you know, like in 2 days, I'm speaking at this conference, and they told me they need another panelist. Do you want to do it? And I was like, oh, okay. Like, I didn't know it. I literally had just moved the city. So I went to speak at this panel. And so I met a guy, which then led on this chain to me helping be a producer on a Grammy-winning jazz album.
That's amazing. And I think it shows the benefit of putting yourself in a position where serendipity can occur. And when it does, not projecting lack or scarcity by trying to get too much too soon. Cause I see that all the time. Like, hey, Terry, can you help me with this? And it's like, I don't even know you. Like, you know, can we build up a bit slower? But often when you're brand new to entrepreneurship, you're like, oh, this person can help me do that. So you go in too quick, but you want to focus on giving first. And sometimes giving is just like your attention and just asking questions about their personal life, not their professional life. And then from there, building a relationship. But I always say, like, if you're at a networking event, one of the best things you can do is say, what do you do for fun? Not what do you do, what do you do for fun? Because they'll naturally be in a good mood while they're talking about it. And you can ask more probing questions. But sometimes we don't think that. We just start looking at the name tag like, useless. Okay, yeah, you're good. You know, how can you help me?
That's so right on. I love that attitude. And, you know, one of the points that I make in the long game, because obviously relationships are a key part of your long term, right? We are shaped profoundly by the people that we know, and the, you know, it controls everything. It impacts what we know, it impacts what opportunities we hear about, et cetera. And so one of the strategies that I propound is something that I call infinite horizon networking, because, you know, so much of networking.
Sorry, hold on. Where do you come up with all these cool names? You always have like cool names for stuff. Is that what you're doing during your white space times? Like, you're like, what's a cool name for this? Bam.
That's right. I actually tried to be more deliberate with this book. I have not previously made an effort to sort of coin terms, but I was like, that would be a cool thing to do. So thank you for noticing, my man. I appreciate that. But yeah, so, you know, what gives networking a bad name is exactly what you described, right? Like, oh, hey, Terry, I see you know so-and-so. Can you introduce me? And it's like, you know, I call it like sneak attack networking. Like, I thought they wanted to be friends, and then, they got me. But infinite horizon networking is deliberately networking with people that seem useless to you. Let's just put it that way. There are people where you're like, okay, like in a million years, would I need anything from this person? I mean, like they're an astronaut and you're a lawyer or something like that, like just completely random. And if you were only operating on the principle of like, who can do something for me, then you wouldn't talk to them. But number one, you can actually have probably a better relationship with them if there's nothing on the table that they can do for you, quote unquote, because you actually get to know them as a person. Number two, life is long and people's paths tend to kind of converge in weird and different ways that are interesting over time. So you never know. And number three, your path might change because of them, because they are exposing you to new ideas and connections and information that other people in your network are not. And so that's actually precisely the reason that you should be thinking about networking through that infinite horizon lens.
I like that approach. And I know it's always like taboo to bring this up, but like, that's one reason why I like CrossFit, is because I meet the most random people there who I would normally not network with. But also I'm like, oh yeah, I'm going to see you every day at the 9:30 class. So now we're talking. And that was my excuse to talk about CrossFit. So thanks for that. But what I wanted to...
I support you, Terry.
Thank you. I've been asking a lot of questions. I want to grab some from the audience right now. This one's from Erica Baker. And a really good question. She's saying, you know, if a client or proposal says multitasking is a skill for a role, would you go running? So basically she's saying like, what dashes do we look out for in regards to opportunities that we know, like, look, this is probably not aligned with our long term. It's not going to be a good fit. How do you filter all these opportunities?
Yeah. See, having a job description where it says, we like people who are good at multitasking. I mean, essentially, you're not wrong, Erica. What they are saying is, we are way too busy. We are going to throw a lot of things at you. We're going to expect you to deal with it. We're actually not going to really help you triage or prioritize because you just have to do all of it all the time. So yeah, I think that strikes me as not the best work environment. Now, if it's your dream job, if it's your dream company and you're like, okay, I guess I'd be okay with working like all the time and having it be really chaotic because it's so important to have this company on your resume, or it's so important because, oh my God, I love that cause, then you know, you can deal with it, but I would consider it not definitive, but I would consider it a red flag.
Yeah. I don't know. When I hear multitasking, I feel like it's disorganized and I'm like, can we just have projects like this gets done and that, then that. So I guess it all, to your point, it depends on the opportunity and how you want to approach it. But, you know, there's so much research that like multitasking's not a good fit, except for the way you described it, but like, it can take like 26 minutes to reset after even a small interruption, like even just looking at your phone to see, oh, Dory emailed me. You start answering the email in your head while you're doing another task, so it can distract you. So I'm very cautious of those opportunities. But we have a great question here from Gretchen, and she's saying, hey, when you say to think in waves, is that based on trends or just changing your approach periodically? Is there a best practice around how long to stick with one approach before moving on?
Oh, really good question. So I'm not necessarily saying chasing trends per se, although it is true in a general sense that if you are pursuing a particular way of doing things and it turns out it is no longer effective, you know, oh, wow, you know, I've made millions of dollars selling bell bottoms. And, you know, like if the market changes, then, you know, maybe indeed we go the skinnier route. But more broadly, what I'm talking about is just thinking about the waves of how we are spending our time and our energy. So specifically in the long game, I actually break down what I call learning waves. And I hope that this could be a kind of useful example. So basically, if we think about the arc of our career and like what we should be investing our time in or how we're doing it early on, if we're just starting period, or if we're starting in a new industry or new company, you're going to start with a learning wave, because you need to know what's what, right? You need to figure out, okay, how does this industry work? Okay, how does this company work? Like who's in charge? Who does what? You know, it's all taking it in. So that makes sense. But you need eventually, once you kind of have a decent handle, you need to shift to what I call creating mode. And that's the place where you start adding your own value. You can't just be the perennial student, like, how do things work here? You know, you need to start contributing. You speak up in meetings, you start sharing things, you start saying, well, what if we did it this way? Or how about we try this? It's putting your own ideas out into the world so that other people can begin to say, oh, well, you know, she makes sense. Oh, that's a good idea. So you're contributing value. Next, you need to think about your connecting wave, because again, early on in, let's say, a particular, you know, company or a particular industry, the people you're going to be doing business with directly, they know you, but most other people don't know you. So you need to make a push so that you can connect with a lot of folks, because over time, what's going to enable you to make an impact is that network, that amplification. You know, the more people who know Terry, the more people who can be sharing his articles, sharing his webinars and saying, oh, you know, yeah, what? You don't know about Terry Rice. Terry's amazing. And they start amplifying for you. Finally, we get to the reaping phase, which is where you've kind of made it, right? Like all the things you've been working toward, you're doing well, you're in a leadership role, your business is going great, etc. It's very easy to coast there. And a lot of people do. But I think it's really important for us to recognize the reaping phase should not be like a final stage. It's not like, oh, okay, good. Now for the rest of my life, I'm just going to like milk it. Because over time, first of all, things do change. Second of all, it's just not satisfying to do literally the same thing forever. We need to recognize that eventually, like, I mean, hey, enjoy it, rock it, but eventually you need to shift. It's not a line, it's a circle. And you need to go back into learning mode to learn something new and different so that you don't just stagnate, but instead you're able to say, okay, I have a new challenge. I have a new mountain to climb and I'm going to learn something so I can begin that process again.
Two things I want to follow up here on. First is actually contributing, you know, making decisions, having ideas and whatnot. And I remember when I was at Facebook, one time we were at dinner and this intern like started ordering appetizers for the table. And I'm like, who are you? Like, you don't know what snacks I like. But he just took that leadership opportunity and he's now very high up at Facebook because of appetizers, right? So I think that makes sense. And the other thing is just realizing the value you have from building a strong network. You brought that up before, because I always say in any kind of business relationship, the most valuable things you have to share are your knowledge, your network, and your compassion. But if you don't have that knowledge built up, it's kind of hard to build your network and then take advantage of their compassion. So even when you're at the top, just continually just learning new skills, because what I found in the past is when I stopped learning new stuff, I would start repeating myself on podcasts and I'm boring myself. They're like, hey, what do you think about this? I'm like, same thing I said last week, right? So it's like, it's so important to just continually search out new information, because to create, you must consume. And if you're not doing that, you will become boring and bored at the same time. So we got some questions here I want to make sure we grab. This one's from Tim. He's saying, no questions, just to tell you how much I enjoy the banter and exchange between Terry and Dory. Well, thank you, Tim. I appreciate that. We're enjoying it too. Hopefully you can tell that. Jean is saying, does Dory do a podcast? She has a really good mic. And what is her handle?
Well, that's very kind. Thank you. I do not have a podcast per se. I actually do a weekly interview show for another publication that I will not name out of respect for Entrepreneur. If you go to doryclark.com, that's my website, and you can sign up for my like self-assessments and stuff there, and you can get all kinds of information. I'll fill you in then.
Well, let's talk about just kind of multitasking. We mentioned a podcast. So this interview is actually going to be in my podcast for Entrepreneur Magazine. So there you go. Right now we're getting two for one here. And I'm following your advice
already. Two for one is my favorite, man. You kill all the birds with one stone. It's a way to do it.
Awesome. So another comment here. This is from Tarana. She's saying, four kids. Wow, you're my hero. Actually, my wife's the hero. She's the one watching the four kids right now. So give her props for that. She might be able to hear me. And let me read this other question here. I'm a CEO at my plant, and I really have a lot of work to do related to plant operations and purchasing raw materials. How can I take time out for marketing and sales? This is the most important area that I'm lacking. Can you help me out?
Yeah, it's so important that you're asking the question, dear reader, because we know in general for all of us that because we are busy, the default is just for our time to be swallowed up and snapped up by all of the kind of urgent things. You know, there's always more to do. Things will take care of themselves when it comes to the sort of urgent needs. No, but how about this? And how about this meeting? So we have to be so incredibly vigilant about guarding our time. And so what I will say, I have a couple of thoughts. The first is that I am a big fan of forcing functions. It's really hard if we are relying constantly on willpower alone, right? Like if you want to lose weight, it's not that you should keep a bunch of Oreos in your cupboard and just every day be like, I'm not going to eat the Oreos. Maybe you just shouldn't have the Oreos in your cupboard. That's a lot easier than every single day saying, oh God, no, I'm not going to eat them. So similarly, how do we create a forcing function for you to think about marketing and strategy? Well, one possibility is you could join some kind of a mastermind or like a professional group, or just find, you know, a like-minded accountability buddy that you respect and carve out a meeting so that literally there's a meeting that you take seriously, but, you know, every 2 weeks, every month, whatever it is, you have that time and you're like, okay, this is the time that I have promised my accountability friend that we are going to talk about strategic thinking in our company. And so something like that can actually, if it's in your calendar, it can help make it real, because otherwise it's an intention, but when it goes in your calendar, it becomes a reality.
You mentioned this before, you should put your to-do list on your calendar. And if you won't put it on your calendar, then it's not that important, right? So that's the way to actually get stuff done and be more productive. It's to actually put it on your calendar and block that time off. So let me hop into the questions and I'll stop with my editorial comments here. But there's a great question from Hina. She's saying, you know, you said when the door is closed, then it go through the window. But what's the number of times you keep on trying an approach before you should give up? Because, again, in regards to the long game, are you somewhat ruining your reputation by being, let's just say, a pest at one point or another? Should you keep on asking over and over again? What would be your advice on that?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, one of the concepts that I talk about in the long game is being directionally correct. And I think this is important, right? If I were so desperate to be featured in Entrepreneur, and you know, Jason Fiverr's like, no, and I try Terry, and Terry's like, no, and then I literally go all the way up and down the masthead where I'm sending LinkedIn messages to everybody who works at Entrepreneur, at a certain point, they're going to have me arrested, right? Like, you know, you just know, no, Dory, sorry. So, you know, I think the answer is like, you try a few times, you try the people, you know, you work your angles. If it doesn't work, okay, fine. But there are other magazines. Even if you can't get into Entrepreneur, there are other ways to reach a business audience. So it's about taking your goals and just, you know, move them up a notch, move them from the 10,000 foot to the 30,000 foot and say, okay, well, actually my goal, like it would be great to be an entrepreneur, but maybe that's not strictly necessary. Maybe there's another magazine. Maybe it's not magazines. Maybe it's podcasts I could be on. Maybe there's live streams I could be on. Maybe it's conferences I could speak at, because ultimately the goal is to reach a business audience with my message. And there are multiple ways to do it. So I'll give you one more example from my own life. When I was in my early 20s, I finished my master's degree. I applied to multiple doctoral programs. I wanted to be a professor. And I got turned down by every single doctoral program, which was extremely disheartening. I thought for sure I'd get into one, but I didn't. So I had to kind of scramble and figure it out. And I had this goal. I'm like, well, I'm going to be a professor and it's going to be so cool. Nope, sorry. But it turns out there's actually multiple ways to be a professor. And so literally within less than 3 years, I mean, a doctoral program would have taken me 7 or 8 years to finish. Then I get to teach. Within less than 3 years, I was teaching a full class at Tufts University, which is a great school, because I had, in the meantime, gotten a job as a journalist, worked as a journalist, and through that window, was able to get a teaching gig based on my professional expertise, teaching a mass media course. And so all of a sudden, I somehow found a way, I stumbled into a way, it's not like I was so clever, but I stumbled into a way to avoid spending 8 years of my life studying something. I avoided hundreds of thousands of dollars in student debt, and I was still able to achieve my goal of being a professor at a top university. So there's often a lot more ways and, you know, methods that you can use than you might imagine or you might have thought of.
I would love for you to tell the story about how you got a job writing for a very popular outlet by selling your bike on Craigslist. Do you mind sharing that story? Because I think it's a great example of serendipity. And some might say that you're lucky, but it was really a function of preparation and opportunity meeting action. Can you just kind of tell us that story as well? Because I love that one.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. Thank you, Terry. Well, so it is true. In the early days of my business, I knew that writing for high profile publications would be very valuable. You know, be a good credibility and a good way to get people to know about me and my business and what I did. So I was trying, you know, left and right, just all these different publications, trying to get noticed, trying to pitch them. Not much luck. You know, people were kind of not getting back to me, or they're dissing me in one way or another. But as a result of it, I had a lot of pitches ready. Like I had a lot of ideas about articles I wanted to write. It was just no one wanted me to write them. But as it happened, as I was going through this process, as Terry mentioned, I was living in Boston at the time, and I sold my bike on Craigslist, and I ended up selling it. It turns out I didn't even know this, but it was to a woman who worked as a copy editor at a local publication. And I didn't know anything about her background, but apparently she had Googled me to essentially make sure I was legitimate and would not actually cheat her out of the money on Craigslist. And she said, oh, I see that, you know, you write, you do business, you know, consulting. She's like, I work for such and such publication. And I was like, oh, hey, I'm like, oh, you have a blog, right? And she's like, yeah. And I said, you know, I'd love to write for that. How do you get to write for that? And she's like, oh, well, you know, I could introduce you. And I'm like, yes, please. So, you know, even that's not the easiest. I had to follow up 2 or 3 times. You know, many people have good intentions, but they're busy. But I eventually followed up. She eventually did introduce me, and I started writing for this publication, which I'm now, you know, it's nearly a dozen years later. And I continue to do that because of this one woman, Josette, who I met selling her my commuter bike.
It's amazing. And it reminds me of my story of how I got involved with Entrepreneur. I met Jason Pfeiffer because our kids were going to the same like gymnastics class in Brooklyn. It was like a free drop-in class, like a free trial. He happened to be there. And I was like, oh my gosh, Jason. But again, same as you, I was prepared with something to talk about because I've been reading Entrepreneur and listening to his podcast. But yeah, it's like shooing my kid away. I'm like, look, dad's trying to do something over here. But again, you have to put yourself in the spot for serendipity to occur, right? And if you don't, and you're not prepared for it when it does happen, you can miss that opportunity. And I see so often people have that opportunity. And the window is like closing. It's so fleeting. But if you don't go in there, if you don't charge, if you don't take action and just, you know, provide some kind of value, it's gone. So being prepared is the best way to do so. But that takes time. That takes white space, right? So if you're so busy doing stuff all the time, you don't have time to exist and to learn. You won't be able to take advantage of those opportunities when they do come along.
Yes, that's exactly right. I love it. And I love that story about your, I'll call that strategic chutzpah.
I like that. I like that.
Yeah, yeah, that's my new article, Terry.
So what I'm going to start doing is selling more stuff on Craigslist and just taking my kids to more classes in Park Slope in Brooklyn, because apparently that works out pretty well.
It's the takeaway for everybody.
But I do want to get to another question here before I have to take off here. So the question is, you know, you recommend a mastermind group. How do you evaluate these programs to see what's the best fit for you? Because like, this is a big commitment. Some of them are a year long, could be tens of thousands of dollars. How do you make sure that, you know, again, in regards to the long game, that you're aligning with the right people who are going to help you advance your professional goals, your personal goals? What's the best way to do that?
Yeah, such an important question. And yeah, I know, right? I run a mastermind group and it is a year long and it does cost tens of thousands of dollars. So yeah, it's a big commitment for a lot of people. So the first thing I'll say is, number one, you don't necessarily have to pay for a mastermind group. You can, for sure. But depending on, you know, I guess the key variables, it depends if you know people that you think would be good to be in it. Like part of the reason that you might pay is if you're just like, okay, I literally in my network do not have the right people. But if you happen to know them and you're willing to expend a little bit of effort being the organizer, because it does take someone to be willing to step up and be like, okay, guys, no, we're meeting on this date. Like, you know, most people are like kind of disorganized. So, but you know, if you're willing to do that, you can often gin up a group for free, which is wonderful. But let's assume that you don't have the right people in your audience that you would, or in your social network that you would want to tap, and you say, yeah, I need to pay for something. I think the most important thing, this is always the tricky part, right? When it comes to a mastermind, is it is the ultimate chicken or egg. It's like, oh, well, do you want to join the mastermind? Well, who else is in the mastermind? And then you've got like 20, you know, 10 people, 20 people, and they're just like, well, who else is in the mastermind? And no one's willing to go in the water first because they're all looking around. So that can be tricky. But ultimately, if you are joining a mastermind that has been around for a while, the best thing, of course, is if you can talk to people who have already been in it to see what it's like, see what the vibe is, see what they've gotten out of it. I think that's really helpful. I think also it's useful to see, you know, you want people who are, I would say they have enough in common with you. It doesn't mean, you know, they have to literally all have the same, business or something like that, but you want to be accomplishing something similar. So for instance, are you at reasonably similar business sizes, or are your goals the same? Like if your goal is all about, oh, well, I really want to understand how to do licensing deals in China, and everybody else is like, yeah, I really want to publish a book. It's like, okay, I mean, you can support each other, but it's not really tactically that helpful. So you want to be a little bit on the same page. And then the big part, of course, is the facilitator. So you want to make sure you really trust and feel good about the facilitator, because ultimately a lot is in their hands about making sure that the sessions are going to be run well and that it's a good community for you. And so I would just take your time following the material that facilitator is putting out, so you can understand, like, do I vibe with that person? Is this someone that I would, you know, there is an element of trust. Like, okay, is this going to be a good experience? Yes or no? I mean, it's kind of the same thing as, I don't know, if you're signing up for a vacation, you're like, okay, do I have enough trust that, you know, I'm going to have a good time if I go to the Four Seasons? And you're like, yeah, you know, over the years, I've heard a lot, you know, the Four Seasons, like, I know it should be nice. I know that if there's a problem, they're pretty likely to be willing to correct it. Okay, great. So how do you feel about the brand that the facilitator or the mastermind is putting out into the world? Do you have the faith that they will work hard to make sure it's a good experience for you?
Amazing. So Dora, you've been very generous with your time. We're at the top of the hour right now. If you have any closing thoughts, you know, you're talking to your best friend and telling them why it's so important to play the long game, what would you say?
Oh my goodness. The book, again, it's The Long Game, How to Be a Long-Term Thinker in a Short-Term World. Why is it so important? It is so important, I believe, because there are small actions that we can take today that will make tomorrow, and I say tomorrow, I mean literally, I mean metaphorically, all the tomorrows better and easier. And why wouldn't we do that? It's not about taking some huge, onerous, hard action. Nobody has time for that. It's about making small strategic shifts so that we can make everything downstream a little easier, a little better. If anyone's interested in like really turning the lens on themselves, go to doryclark.com/thelonggame. You can get a free self-assessment and figure out how to be a more long-term thinker in your own life, your own career, and your own entrepreneurial venture. And I'm cheering all of you on. And Terry Rice, thanks for having me, my man.
Thank you so much. It's been great for me. I'm seeing a lot of great feedback in the chat window here as well. So I'll let you go because I know you have a lot to do. The book's coming out the 21st. So I want to make sure you can do your tour here. But thank you. This has been amazing. And I do appreciate your time.
Thank you so much. Great to be here. And thanks, everyone. Wonderful to get to spend the afternoon with you. Take care.
Take care.